What's going on, all my healthcare brothers and sisters? I hope that you are having a wonderful day. Today, we are continuing on with the cardiovascular assessment and electrocardiogram, like a boss series, and we're gonna start looking at our junctional rhythms. Before we begin, I want you to take a look up here on the right side of your screen. You're gonna see two different sets of stoplights. Our first set of stoplight is gonna tell us about our rhythm. Is it a good rhythm? Is it a rhythm we should be cautious about? Or is it a lethal rhythm? Those not really good rhythms. And our next one is gonna be either a green person letting us know that we can play our Monopoly game, collect our $200 and keep going, or it needs to be red, stop, we need to do something about this before it gets worse. Let's begin by looking at our junctional rhythm. So the rate will be between 40 to 60 beats per minute, and the rhythm will be regular. P waves will either be inverted, absent, or seen after the QRS. The PR interval will be less than 0.12 seconds when they are present, and the QRS interval will remain normal. The definition for this rhythm is the sinoatrial node fails to send an impulse, or a blockage in the conduction system will initiate a premature junctional beat. It consists of six or more escape beats, and P waves may precede, followed, or be buried in the QRS. So what are some causes of junctional rhythms? It could be hypoxemia, digitalis toxicity, or a potassium imbalance. Intervention-wise, we're going to provide oxygen if oxygenation is inadequate, if it's less than 94%, and we can also provide potassium replacements if levels are low. If the patient is symptomatic, we may follow the symptomatic sinus bradycardia algorithm, and we may also need to consider temporary or permanent pacemaker placement. Next, we're moving on to our junctional tachycardia rhythm. So the rate of this rhythm will be between 100 to 160 beats per minute. The rhythm will be regular, and P waves will again be either inverted, absent, or seen after the QRS. PR intervals will be less than 0.1 seconds, and the QRS interval will also remain normal as before. The definition is really the same, the only difference is the rate of the rhythm. So causes for this rhythm can include hypoxemia, that digitalis toxicity that we've discussed multiple times, decreased cardiac output, acute myocardial infarction, we could also see myocarditis, as well as post-open heart surgery. This can occur more frequently with people who have had post-open heart surgery. So junctional tachycardia interventions include oxygenation if the oxygenation is not adequate, less than 94%. We can consider vagal maneuvers, adenosine, calcium channel blockers such as diltiazem, as well as our beta blockers. So we begin with our vagal maneuvers. This is the first line management when it comes to our tachycardias. So what are some different techniques that we can do? Well, coughing is a big one. It creates the same physiological response as bearing down, and it's easily performed. The cough must be forceful and sustained. So if you have a patient that's going, that's not gonna do it. You have to, it has to be a forceful and sustained cough. Cold stimulus to the face, ice packs to the face, or a washcloth that has been soaked in ice for about 10 seconds could be useful. Again, it creates the same physiological response like being submerged in cold water. That's also called the diver's reflex. A carotid massage, it's performed on the patient's neck when the neck is extended and turned away from the carotid. So you have to have an extension and turned away from the carotid that you are going to massage. We only want to massage one carotid at a time for no more than 10 seconds. We don't want to massage both because now we're impeding blood from going to the brain. Something else that you might have to consider, and the reason why we don't recommend this for all patients, is some patients will have a lot of carotid plaque buildup. So they could have a carotid that's potentially 90% occluded, and then they have another carotid that's like 80% occluded. So if you're occluding it and they're not really getting a good amount of blood flow to the brain anyways, it can actually make it worse. So we don't recommend this for all patients. This would probably be something that I would do last. Gagging, stimulating the vagus nerve by placing a tongue depressor in the back of the patient's throat. This is probably not comfortable for the patient. I don't know about you, they might throw up, I don't know. I've never done it, but this can also be another option. And bearing down, which is the one that we see most common when we're doing those vagal maneuvers, is instructing the patient to bear down like they're having a bowel movement, or having them blow through an occluded 10 ml syringe for approximately 15 to 20 seconds as shown in the picture above. So let's talk about adenosine. This is such a fun drug, not for the patient, but it's fun to watch. It's the first drug of choice for stable narrow complex supraventricular tachycardias, and it may also be considered for unstable narrow complex tachycardias while we're waiting for that cardioversion to occur. It does not convert atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, or ventricular tachycardia, so that's something important to note, and we don't use that for those things. So adenosine dosing. We want to place the patient in a mild reverse Trendelenburg position, so they're just going to be a little slightly up. The initial bolus is going to be 6 milligrams given rapidly over 1 to 3 seconds. You want to push this quick. That's going to be followed by a normal saline flush of 20 mLs, and we want to elevate the extremity that we have delivered the medication through, so that way it gets to the heart quicker. Anytime we have these medications, we want to elevate the extremity afterwards, get it to where it needs to go quicker. We can provide a second dose of 12 milligrams IV push over 1 to 2 minutes if needed. I have seen it given more than once. I have seen it given twice. If it doesn't work after 2 times, it's probably not going to work. So let's talk about diltiazem. So we use this to control ventricular rates and atrial fibrillation and atrial flutter. And it's used after adenosine to treat refractory SVT with adequate blood pressures. So with dosing, an acute rate is going to be between 15 to 20 milligrams IV over 2 minutes. We could give another IV dose in 15 minutes at 20 to 25 milligrams over 2 minutes as well if it's needed. Maintenance infusions will be between 5 to 15 milligrams per hour, and we titrate based on the heart rate. Normally, this medication is diluted in either D5W or normal saline. Lastly, considerations we might want to consider is we don't want to use calcium channel blockers in the presence of poison, drug-induced tachycardia, Wolff-Parkinson's-White syndrome, plus a rapid atrial fibrillation and flutter, sick sinus syndrome, or AV block without pacemaker. And we also want to avoid in patients receiving oral beta blockers, as these calcium channel blockers can make it worse. So let's talk about our beta blockers. So beta blockers can convert to normal sinus rhythm or to a slow ventricular response, or it could do both. It is a second drug of choice after adenosine, and it reduces myocardial ischemia and damage in acute myocardial infarction patients with elevated heart rates, blood pressure, or both. Beta blocker dosing is different depending on the medication. Let's begin with propranolol. It can be between 0.5 to 1 milligram over 1 minute and can be repeated as needed up to 0.1 milligrams per kilogram as a total dose. Esmolol is 0.5 milligrams per kilogram over 1 minute, followed by 0.05 milligrams per kilogram per minute for infusions. The maximum dose we want to give is 0.3 milligrams per kilogram per minute, and higher doses really are unlikely to be beneficial. Lastly, labetalol. That it can be given 10 milligrams IV push over 1 to 2 minutes, and you could repeat or double every 10 minutes to a maximum dose of 150 milligrams, or give an initial dose as a bolus followed by an infusion at 2 to 8 milligrams per minute. So consideration with our beta blockers. We do not want to give to patients that are having ST elevated myocardial infarctions if the following presentations, such as heart failure, low cardiac output, or increased risk of cardiogenic shock are present. Additional contraindications may include PR intervals that are greater than 0.24 seconds, second-degree heart blocks, third-degree heart blocks, active asthma, reactive airway disease, severe bradycardia, systolic blood pressures that are less than 100, early aggressive beta blocker treatment can be detrimental in hemodynamically unstable patients, so we don't want to use that. And concurrent calcium channel blocking administration. If you give them both at the same time, it can cause severe hypotension and bradycardia, or even potentially heart blocks. Lastly, we're gonna look at our accelerated junctional rhythm. So this rate is gonna be between 61 to 100 beats per minute. The rhythm is gonna be regular, and the P waves again are gonna be either inverted, absent, buried, or retrograde. The PR interval when present is gonna be either short or retrograde, and the QRS interval will remain normal. The definition of this rhythm is the automaticity is enhanced on the atrial ventricular node, firing faster than the SA node, resulting in a regular, narrow complex rhythm with a rate greater than 60 but less than 100. Causes for accelerated junctional include sick sinus syndrome, digitalis toxicity, post-open heart surgery, ischemia of that atrial ventricular node, acute inflammatory processes such as rheumatic fever or Lyme disease, medication side effects from beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and most antiarrhythmic medications. In well-conditioned adults as well as children who are asleep, this actually can be considered normal. And junctional rhythms may exhibit symptoms and may also be asymptomatic. So symptoms mostly are determined by the heart rate itself and how we treat it. So for accelerated junctional interventions, accelerated junctional rhythms often act as a compensatory mechanism to help aid in cardiac output. So treatment is not often required unless there's some kind of tachycardia present. Treatment is determined by reversing the underlying cause, but we have to be careful because it could also cause low cardiac output due to a loss of that atrial kick. I hope that this video was helpful in elevating your cardiac knowledge and helping you pass those exams like a boss. Make sure that you check out my website at www.nursechung.com where you can get copies of these resources, the PowerPoints, as well as test questions that I will be including with each one of these videos within the series. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them down below. I love answering your questions, and make sure you follow me on my social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, as well as here on YouTube. Make sure you subscribe and make sure you turn on that notification bell. Until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I can't wait to see you all again soon. Bye.